Hello everyone, this is Sandhya Rani and today's our topic is view serializability. So already in the previous lecture we discussed about the conflict serializability, and one more type of serializability is here, view serializability. So in view serializability, what are the conditions can be taken? So here every time we are going to observe the schedule, so already we were very well know that what is a schedule means, the set of instructions executed in each and every transaction which are going to be defined in the same order, we are going to write in the same order, so that what we call it as here the schedule. Then every time the view serializability schedule, that must be view equivalent, so that must be view equivalent to a serial schedule, that must be view equivalent to a serial schedule. So already we discussed in conflict serializable schedule, when a conflict occurs, it means we are already discussed about what are the three cases, like accessing same data item, two different transactions, at least one must be write operation. In the similar case also, in view serializability also, you can discuss the three conditions. So when will be a schedule can be view equivalent to a serial schedule, when the schedule will be view equivalent to a serial schedule. So for suppose we are taking the two schedules, let us take the first schedule is S1 and the second schedule is S2. In this schedule also we can execute the two transactions, T1 and T2, and this schedule also you can execute T1 and T2, two different transactions. So this is schedule 1 and I am calling it as schedule 2, and when the schedule will be equivalent, view equivalent to schedule 2, means almost both are equal. So in this case we can apply the three conditions, when a schedule S1 will be view equivalent to S2. The what are the three conditions here? For example, in S1 schedule, let us take the T1 transaction. If the T1 transaction performs read operation, so it is reading a data item, for suppose take the Q. So Q is a data item. So just like you can take a X or whatever it may be. So if T1 initially it reads the value Q, then automatically in schedule 2 also the T1 transaction must read the initial value of Q. So whatever the value is, initial value is read in the T1 transaction in S1 schedule, the same read operation can be executed in S2. So this is the first condition. And next one, second condition, if in a schedule 1 it performs final write operation. So nothing but for let us take, it performs a final write queue of operation. Similarly in S2 also it executes the write queue operation. So if it is performs write queue operation, if any transaction in S1 schedule is executing write operation, similarly in S2 schedule also the transaction must execute the write queue operation. So this is the second case. And third case is, so it performs read queue. S1 schedule performs read queue. When it will performs read queue? For example, if T2 transaction is executing read queue, then what performs here? T1 transaction must completed write of queue, first thing. So after it executing the write operation, then the T2 transaction read that value. Why? Because it reads the updated value. So nothing but if any transaction is executing read of queue, Already it must execute the write of queue. If T1 transaction after completion of write of queue operation, then T2 executes the read operation. So nothing but T1 completes the write operation. After the write only, it reads the updated value. So likewise, T2 executes the read of queue. When it executes the read of queue? After write queue by the T1. So the same operation can be executed in S2 also. So if the T1 is executing the write queue operation, it writes the operation, and after completion of the write operation, T2 performs the read operation. These three are the cases in which a schedule 1, which is view equivalent to schedule 2. Means what are the three conditions? First thing, first in schedule 1, if any transaction reads the queue value, similarly S2 also the read queue will be executed. Next, in second case, if in a schedule 1, if any write operation is going to be performed, final write operation is going to be completed, then S2 also completes the final write operation. Next, third case, if any transaction is executing the read before the transaction that must be. So in three cases, a view equivalent schedule. In three cases, the view schedule will be view equivalent to another schedule. What are the three cases here? First, initially in schedule 1, if it reads the initial value queue, then the same initial value queue can be read in the schedule 2. If it performs the final write queue operation in schedule 1, it also performs the final write operation. In schedule 1, if it performs the write operation, after the write operation, then next transaction can perform the read operation. Similarly, in S2 also, the same. It can perform the read, any transaction can read the operation after completion of the write operation of a transaction. So, in this case, the schedule 1, which is view equivalent to a schedule 2. So, likewise, simply automatically the schedule T may be equal to which schedule? Serial schedule. So, in these three cases, a schedule can be view equivalent to a serial schedule. Okay, so next you can move to one more transaction called concurrent control mechanism, concurrent control mechanism using locks. So, multiple transactions are executing here. So, we are already very well discussed it, that T1, T2, T3 in likewise, n number of transactions are executing in a database system. So, for this system, you are going to impose some kind of control mechanism without any control. So, all the transactions are going to be competing and the system can be executing. So, likewise, so in order to execute all those perfectly, without any conflicts, without any errors or dirty read problems or incorrect problems, you going to execute all these transactions perfectly. So, for this purpose, you can impose a locking mechanism. You can place a lock. So, you can place a lock while at the time of execution of transaction. So, for example, this is just like similar to while we are holding one call, while we are receiving one call on one call. So, if any anyone made any different types of calls to the same number, then automatically, so the system already, the lock is going to be placed to one thing. So, for this purpose, we can't access one more one. So, for this purpose, you are going to place a lock on particular transaction. Similarly, the same technique is going to be applied for the database system also. Likewise, you are going to impose a lock. So, here, how many types of locks are there? Generally, how many types of operations we are executing? Only you are executing read operation and write operation. So, in order to execute the read operation, you are going to place shared lock. In order to execute both read and write operations, you are going to place exclusive lock. So, shared lock simply we are going to be calling it as S, and exclusive lock we are going to be call it as X. So, then how the system can use the compatibility of locking? So, when the locking can be used here? So, this can be observed with a table here. So, you can take here shared lock and exclusive lock. Similarly, shared lock and exclusive lock here. So, shared and shared can, if you are reading and some other person can also read. So, shared and shared you can possible, it can be possible. And if you are giving the shared read operation, then write operation, somebody is executing write operation, so you can't give the privileges, so it will not be accessed. So if it is write operation, so then after completion of the write, before no one can be read, so it will, the privilege cannot be given. So for write, if any other transaction wants to write, then the privilege cannot be given. So only the read privilege is going to be provided, and it can't provide the write accessing permission is not going to be provided here. So, likewise, the system can give the permission for read operation and for write operation. So, let us discuss this with one example. You can define with one more example here. So, let us take the T1 and T2 transaction here also. Similarly, so here we are going to take account B, banking transaction. Let us take banking transaction. Account B and account A, two transactions are going to be there here. The funds are going to be transferred from account B to account A. So, for suppose the balance of account B, we are going to be, let us take 200, and account A is 100, and the funds which are going to be transferred are 50 rupees are transferred from account B to account A. Let us take the total amount of account B is 200 and account A is 100, and 50 rupees are going to be transferred from account B to account A. So what is the T1 transaction? The T1 transaction executes, the funds are transferred, the funds are transferred from account B to account A. So this is the T1 transaction. And T2 transaction here, it find out, displays the total amount, the total balance. It displays the total balance of both account A and account B. So here you can define with the schedule. So here we can define with the schedule. You can write what will be happened in the schedule here. So what is the T1 transaction? The funds which are transferred from account B to account A. First of all, you are going to read which transaction, which data item? B. So let us take, you are reading B. So read of B. So amount 50 rupees is going to be transferred. So B colon equal to B minus 50. So and you can execute the write operation, write of B. And this can be transferred to account A. So you can execute the read of A, and the funds will be added to A. So A plus 50, and here write of A. So in order to execute this perfectly, so you are executing both read and write operation for the data item B. And here also you are writing read on write operation for a data item A. So you are performing write operation. So for this purpose, which lock you are going to place? Exclusive lock. So lock, exclusive lock means X on which data item? B. So for this purpose, you are going to take lock, exclusive lock on which data item? B. So and here also you are going to take which lock here? Lock, exclusive lock on which data item? A. So after the completion of read and write operation, simply you can unlock, simply you can release, unlock X of B and unlock X of A. So you can provide the place the locks and you can release the locks. You can, after completion of write operation, you can release the locks. And what is performed for the T2 transaction? It displays the total balance for both accounts. So first it can performs read B, and it performs read A, and it displays total of sum of A plus B or B plus A. So only just reading, it not performing any write operation. So which lock you are going to place? Shared lock. Lock, shared lock. So that's why we are going to take S. Lock S of B. So and here also you are going to perform shared, only read operation, shared S of A. So and you can execute both the sum of A plus B, and after that you can release the lock. Unlock which lock? S of B, and unlock S of A. So likewise, you are going to place the locks, right? So the funds are going to be transferred from account B to account A in the T1 transaction. So you can write B minus 50, and it can be added to account A. And you are executing write operation, so that's why you are placing the exclusive lock. So lock X of B, and here also here lock X of A, and finally you can unlock, release the locks. And here only just displaying the amount without performing any write operation. So here you can simply take the shared lock. So likewise, you can place shared lock and exclusive lock in order to execute the different set of transactions in a particular schedule. Then it will be executed perfectly without any conflict. Without any conflict, it will be clearly executed. So hope you understood. In the next further video, we will discuss about the multiple granularity and different kinds of techniques which are used in lockings. So and hope you will understood, and thanks for watching. Thank you.